My coach is due at any moment, Mrs. Grafton. So I will not detain you from your morning's work. Goodbye.
You are a wicked, ungrateful girl. Do not turn away from me, Jane Eyre. I have something to say. We have one way of dealing with teachers who run off and leave us short-handed. When they return, begging for shelter, this gate is locked. We have our ways of dealing with ingratitude.
For what am I supposed to be grateful? For the years of humiliation? I pity the wretched, trusting children that passed through this gate into your merciless hands.
How dare you?
For I was one of those children. I have waited 18 years to escape this place. And to escape you, Miss Scatcherd. No. I shall never return. It is true. I have no family or friends. But God gave me spirit, which even Lowood School was unable to quench. My coach is coming.
God will punish you.
No. I think it will be you that will be punished.
You step this way, miss.
How do you do, my dear?
Mrs. Fairfax?
Yes, that's right. John, will you take Miss Eyre's bag up to her room? Lear, bring the tea into the library, please. Oh, do come in, my dear. Let me take your cloak. Did you have a very tedious ride?
Oh, no, indeed. The country is so beautiful at this season.
John drives so slowly. You must be numb with the cold. Do come in by the fire.
So lovely. I've never seen a house like it.
But cold, cold and empty, and without laughter. Perhaps you will bring warmth to it.
Is this the little girl?
Yes, do sit down, Miss Eyre, for whom I answered your advertisement for governess.
Yes, Miss Eyre, this is Adele. I'm afraid she fell fast asleep waiting for you to come. She has prattled of the whole week that you're coming.
Seems a pity to wake
her. Oh, but she has to go up to bed. Besides, she'd be most unhappy if she didn't meet you tonight. I forgot to mention in my letter that she was born on the continent, though she speaks English quite prettily. Adele. Adele! See who's here. Miss Eyre has come.
Oh, bonsoir, mademoiselle.
Bonsoir, Adele. Oh, I do believe we are going to be good friends.
Mais certainement. Mademoiselle, are you from Paris, too?
No, Adele. Is that where you were born?
Oui, oui. I lived long ago with Mama. Mama has gone to the Holy Virgin. She taught me to sing and dance and say welfare.
Then you shall sing and say a piece for me tomorrow.
And will you love my cher Mr. Rochester when he comes?
Oh, I shall do my best to please him.
Thank you, Lear. Adele, Lear will take you up to the nursery now. You will be able to talk to Miss Eyre tomorrow.
Bon oui, chère mademoiselle.
Dormez bien.
Good night, Mrs. Fairfax.
Run along now.
Come along, Miss Adele. Time for bed.
Oh, she's charming.
She will be grateful for your company. There hasn't been enough for her to do here to keep her occupied.
Thank you, Mrs. Fairfax. You make me... You're so very welcome.
I, too, shall be grateful for your company. For to speak truthfully, we're much alone here. Mr. Rochester is away so much in Europe.
Shall I be required to meet him tonight?
Oh, dear, no. Mr. Rochester has been away these past 3 months. He sometimes returns for a week or so, and then he's off again.
Does he not like it here at Thornfield? It's so beautiful.
He appears to find it too gloomy.
I do not. Have you any knowledge of when he is likely to return this time?
Oh, no. Mr. Rochester's visits, Miss Eyre, are often sudden and unexpected. Like everything about him, unpredictable.
Is he an exacting master?
Oh, not particularly. But he has a gentleman's tastes and habits, and he expects to find things managed in that way.
Is he generally like?
There's not a finer man in Yorkshire. Though there are many who find him abrupt and strange.
Strange? In what respect?
is only that sometimes when you speak to him, it's as though he were listening for someone else.
Who is that?
Just one of the servants, my dear. Grace Poole, a woman we have to help with the sewing. And now I'm sure you're more than ready to retire to your room.
I am a little tired.
Well, I've put you into one of the guest rooms so that you can be as comfortable as you are accustomed to being.
I'm accustomed to very little, Mrs. Eyre.
You're not one of the servants, Miss Eyre. You're a person of refinement. I hope you will learn to look upon Thornfield as your home. And now I'm sure Leah has unpacked your bag. My room is near to yours, so should you feel nervous in the night, you have only to call. Like all old houses, Thornfield sometimes has strange stirrings at night.
Fortunate girl indeed, Jane Eyre. You must work very hard to be worthy of such kindness. Oh, I love this house. It's as though it were my own.
Servants. They sometimes talk loudly with Grace at night. And now, my dear, why do you not take your rest? You have traveled many miles.
Good night, Mrs.
I was unused to the wind at first.
Oh, you get accustomed to it, Miss, like everything else.
Oh, I've loved it here these past few weeks.
Oh.
It's been...
Jane, I'm so thankful you're not yet asleep and that you haven't gone to bed. Now, Leah, run downstairs quickly and tell Bess to prepare a hot supper. The master has just arrived from London.
Mr. Rochester is here?
Yes, he arrived a few moments ago. Now, Jane, you must come quickly to the library. No, he was not expected, but as I told you, his arrivals and departures are always unpredictable. He wishes to see you, and he does not like to be kept waiting. Come quickly, child. Answer only to what you are asked. No more and no less. Come, make haste, for he is impatient and a little irritable after his long journey.
Miss Eyre?
Miss Eyre is here, sir.
You may retire, Mrs. Fairfax.
Yes, sir. Good night, sir.
Good night, Mrs. Fairfax. Come around here where I can see you. Be seated, if you please. Well, a little nearer. Here. I'm not a mad dog about to bite. I cannot observe you without disturbing my position in this comfortable chair, which I've no mind to do. Well, then, you came from...
Where was it?
Ah, yes. A charitable institution. How long were you there?
18 years, sir.
You must be tenacious of life. I thought you had the look of another world about you. I wondered where you'd gotten that sort of a face. Who were your parents?
I have none, sir.
You must have some sort of kinfolk.
No, sir. None that I have ever seen.
Well, who recommended you to come here?
I advertised. Mrs. Fairfax answered my advertisement.
Your age?
Just 20, sir.
I see. Are you musical? Can you play on the spinet?
A little.
And the established dancer. Well, go over to the spinet, if you please, and play to me. That's enough. You play a little, as you say. You examine me, Miss Eyre. Do you find me handsome?
No, sir.
On my word. There's something singular about you. You sit quiet and grave with your eyes in the carpet and your hands in your lap, and then of a sudden you rap out an answer like that. Explain yourself.
There is nothing to explain,
sir. I see. Well, you're very straightforward. That's something I like. You nervous with me?
No, sir. Could I be?
Well, some seem to think so. So you're not nervous. Well, that's good, for you'll find me abrupt. I once had a feeling of heart, Miss Eyre, but the fortunes of this world have knocked it out of me. You look puzzled. No, you're no more beautiful than I'm handsome. A puzzled air becomes you. That's all, Miss Eyre.
Thank you, sir. I shall do my best to give satisfaction. Good night, Mr. Rogers.
Good night, Miss Eyre.
Not to eat it until after lunch.
Adele, your luncheon is on the table.
Oh, bon. Then I do not have to do my arithmetic, Adele.
Indeed you do. We will not go for a walk until you have finished your sum.
But, ma'am...
Now, run along, no arguments. Is Mr. Rochester expected back this afternoon?
So he said. But if Lady Ingram's ball lasted far into the night, he may have decided to stay another day.
Oh, I hope, Ma. He promised you he'd let me sing for him this evening.
She really sings very nicely. We were practicing just a moment ago.
May I sing my song before I go?
Yes, you may. It will not take long.
Au clair de la lune, mon ami Pierrot, prêtez-moi sa plume pour écrire un mot.
Oh, monsieur, you almost to him for tonight.
Oh, Mr. Rochester, we did not expect you so soon. I must see that some luncheon is prepared for you.
I do. Tell others, no hurry.
Run along, Adele. Your lunch will be waiting. Come, Adele. Sir, we did not think it possible for you to return until late this afternoon.
I drove the horses hard. You know why I was so glad to return?
No, sir.
All the way home, I kept thinking of something I wished to ask you, Miss Eyre.
Ask me, sir?
Yes. I wished to have you dine with me this evening. Will you do me that courtesy?
Sir, it is not usual for a dumb...
Tonight, then, Jane.
As you wish.
Mm-hmm.
speak, Jane.
About what, sir?
Anything you please. I'm in the mood to be gregarious and communicative tonight. What?
Thank you, no, sir.
That'll be all then, John.
Yes, sir.
As you see, Jane, I've usually only the fire to keep me company. I'm sure you can suit me better than that. From the very first, you intrigued me. I wish to learn more about you, so speak.
Indeed, sir, there is nothing to learn.
You think me a fool, Jane?
Oh, no, sir. Far from it. May I ask if you are a philanthropist?
Good Lord, no.
That's not my reason in wishing to draw you out.
Truth, though, there's something very singular about you. Those quiet, grave eyes.
Do you never laugh, Jane?
Only when I'm amused, sir.
And I've yet to amuse you, huh?
Well, I don't laugh very much either. There's not much to laugh at in this world. I was not always the man you see before you. Nature's changed me. I might have been as good as you when I remember myself at 18.
How good is your memory, sir?
Well taken, Jane. And I've not been good entirely. You know why Adele is here?
No.
She's supposed to be my child. That does not shock you.
You have told me yourself, sir, which provides a reason there can be no great sin attached to it.
Well, you're right. Her mother was a dancer in Paris whom I loved and courted and lost. Later, when I heard she'd abandoned her child to run off to Italy with a musician, I brought the child home to England here. Well, I suppose now you'll be coming to me with your notice to find a new governess.
Adele is not answerable to her mother's fault, or to yours, sir.
You say that as if it were the most usual thing in the world. That's what's so unusual about you. Well, I've loved Jane, but I've found no happiness. I don't suppose you can conceive how I hate Thornfield.
I loathe this building and everything it contains.
Are you deserting me so soon, Jane?
If you will permit me, sir, I should like to retire.
You think I've already overstepped the bounds of our relationship, huh?
I'm only a governess.
No, Jane, you're not a governess. Not once in 12,000.
Good night, sir.
I don't merely mean to flatter you, Jane. But you're cast in a different mold than anyone I've ever seen.
Good night, Mr. Russell.
Good night, Jane.
Who's there?
Uh,
might have been burned to death in your sleep. How did it happen? I'd better call Mrs. Fairfax.
No.
Don't awaken me.
No, call no one. It was an accident.
I found this lighted candle by my door. I heard a strange laugh.
You heard what?
Laughter. Mr. Rochester, someone meant to murder you tonight. Who is it? Who is that person, great fool?
You know it's something to do with Grace Poole. Jane, it's well that no one but you knows anything of this occurrence. It must remain that way, do you understand? A coal from the fire set alight to my chair.
The fire's dead?
Repeat after me, a coal from the fire.
A coal from the fire.
I knew you'd do me some good, Jane. I saw it in your eyes the first time we met.
It's hurting my hands.
Good night, gentle benefactress. And lock your door!
Just a moment, Mother. Just see how the leaves
are coming. But only for a moment, then. For to wake the roof be up, and there's a chill in the garden.
Is that the haughty lady who sings?
Yes, she's very beautiful.
I do not think so.
Any man today would find you a great acquisition, madame.
Oh, I'm sick of the young men today. Weaklings with pretty faces and white hands, full of flattery and mincing ways. I like a man to be a man. A good huntsman, a fine shot, ready to take up a fight. Do you not agree, Edwin?
You mean to say that you admire ugliness in a man?
A man need not necessarily be handsome to arouse my interest.
Well, I'm glad to hear it. But my governess thinks me ugly. She's told me so herself.
What impertinence. This should be thought a thing. You referred to that Jane as a person who cursed it to me in the courtyard this morning.
Yes, that's Jane.
Jane, indeed. A suitable name for such a sparrow. She's doubtless dazzled by her first association with quality.
Nevertheless, she has a quiet and pleasing touch in the spinet. I'd have a play for you.
A governess to perform for us. That will be a new experience, Mama.
Yeah. Sir?
I've come to ask you to play to us.
If you will excuse me, sir, I was about to put Adele to bed. She wanted to stay up for a few moments to see the party.
Well, cannot Leah put her to bed?
No, Papa. Look,
what? Never you mind, miss. Up you go.
I do not really mind. Oh, I do not think the haughty lady seems well at all.
And off you go now.
If you will excuse me, sir, I prefer not.
For me, Jane.
Did I tell you, Edward, about the fuss over Lady Charlotte's ball? You know what dull affairs they usually are, and I was determined to arrive late.
It is more fashionable to arrive late.
That foolish Charlotte was so cross with me because I interrupted an Italian diva with my entrance, which, though I should suppose, was splendidly timed.
Jane plays well, don't you think?
Tolerably. Lord Charlesbrook took me into supper, though the ball was given as a last desperate effort to marry off Charlotte this season. She'll be 23 this year, and everyone says she'll be an old maid, even with a dowry of £6,000 a year. Thank you, that was charming. Your governess is not assessed to the best manners, Edward, I would say. I'm surprised that you would permit to have somebody in your household behaving in such a manner.
Child, you catch cold in the night air. Why do you stand here in the garden?
Still night is conducive to still thoughts, Mrs. Fairfax.
You sound like you.
I am sad, for I love this place, and I must leave it.
Leave it?
Yes. Oh, Mrs. Fairfax, you are a true friend, are you not?
I hope I am, Jane.
I feel that you are. That's why I can tell you. I love Mr. Rochester.
Oh, child, I feel deeply sorry for you. Have you so much mistaken his interest in you, Jane?
I think not.
He's a lonely man. He's found you a ready listener. That he likes. It is nothing more, Jane.
I know it is nothing more. I am not beautiful and gifted like Blanche Ingram. He will marry her for her rank and connections. So I think she does not charm him greatly.
Do not count on that, Jane.
Though she smiles so lavishly upon him, I think she does not feel anything deeply.
Mr. Rochester has a fortune, Jane, and the Lady Ingram has been lately impoverished. She will not let him go if she can do aught to hold him.
Is he so blind?
All men are blind, Jane. Oh, child, child.
Do not pity me, Mrs. Fairfax. Only help me.
Jane. Why did you leave the room?
I was tired, sir.
And a little hurt.
Good night.
I've come to ask forgiveness for the rudeness of my guests, Jane.
That is not necessary.
Come here, Jane. Here to my side. You're paler than usual, Jane. What about?
Nothing. I'm a little tired.
And a little depressed. What about? Tell me.
I am not depressed.
I see you are. So much so that a few words bring tears to your eyes. I can see them there now, shining and swimming. Don't you trust me, Jane?
Yes, sir. Always.
Am I not your friend?
Yes. You are my friend.
Then tell me.
Edward, you desert us for the entire evening.
Good night, my.
Habit of a gentleman of your position and means to spend his time talking with a servant.
Well, Miss Eyre is no more a servant than I'm a man of means, my dear Blanche.
What a strange jest for one who is known to be worth £40,000 a year.
I'm glad this came up, for I would not have you suffering such an illusion, my lady.
Illusion?
I had means once, it's true, but I lost the greater share of my fortune in a foolish speculation in South America this year. Well, I thought, of course, you knew. I know, Blanche, that this will have no effect on our mutual regard for each other. You've told me so often that my fortune was what you least admired, the least of my assets. Now, may I offer you some claret before we retire?
You're leaving us?
We've just heard a rumor in the servants' hall.
Yes, it is true, Leah.
Oh, I am sorry, Miss. Thornfield won't be the same without you.
That's kind of you, Leah.
Are you going to another position, Miss?
I've heard of one in Ireland.
Oh, they say Ireland is very beautiful.
Oh, mademoiselle! Oh, mademoiselle! Do let go! Do let go! Has Papa been unkind to you?
No, darling. But I must go. It is sometimes necessary for dear friends such as we to part.
Take me with you, then.
You know I cannot do that. Here. Take it over to the nursery, please, and don't cry. I will speak to Miss Eyre.
No, I do not go.
You must go. And I will come up and bid you goodbye before my coach leaves. The master has just returned from driving Lady Ingram and Lady Blanche to Lees.
I'd hope to leave before he returned.
He wishes to see you. Oh, my dear. He was most angry when I told him of your intention to leave.
I shall leave, nevertheless, Mrs. Fair.
Oh, I understand your feelings, child. But what will you say to him?
I don't know. I shall make some excuse for myself.
What's this all about, Jane?
I'm sorry to have angered you, sir. It was my intention to tell you myself.
Well, Jane, what have I done?
Nothing. Nothing to offend you, sir, believe me. It's only that I must leave Thornfield.
Then what I've heard is true.
Yes, sir.
Where do you see the necessity?
You, sir, have placed it before me.
In what shape?
In the shape of Miss Ingram, sir. Your bride.
My bride? I have no bride.
But you will.
Yes. Yes, I will.
Oh, sir, it is not my place to intercede. Not wishing to offend, sir, I think it best that you send Adele to school and that I find a position elsewhere. I have heard of one in Ireland.
Ireland? Do you need to go so far?
The sea will be a barrier.
From what, Jane?
From England. Thornfield.
Well?
And you.
We have kin in one thing, I wonder, Jane. You don't answer. I sometimes have a queer feeling with regard to you when you're near me. As now, I feel I have a string tied under my heart, inextricably knotted to a similar string under yours. I have a notion if it were ever severed, I might bleed to death. You'll quickly forget me, Jane.
That I will never do, sir.
Are you crying, Jane?
No, sir.
Because you're sorry to leave Thornfield?
I grieve to leave Thornfield, sir. For I love this house. And I shall always remember you.
You know, you're not as clear-eyed as I thought you were, Jane. You've let me down. You don't look as far as you should. Have you ever thought to inquire as to why I've stayed at Thornfield all these months? I've never stayed here more than a week before. I've always hated it here. Do you know why I'm staying now?
No, sir.
Because if God is my judge, I've wrestled with conscience and torture for all these months. But by heaven, and may heaven forgive me, I can wrestle no more. Jane, you shall be convinced, Jane. It's because of you. Because of you, don't you hear me? What love is Blanche Ingram for me? None. What love have I for her? None but you. You are my love, Jane. My life, my happiness. You, small and obscure and poor and plain as you are, I cannot live without you.
Oh, sir, you hurt me too dreadfully. Please do not make sport of me.
Make sport of you? For my love, Jane. Jane, will you marry me? I can't bear it any longer. I've loved you from that first quiet moment when you stepped into this library.
Sir, then you aren't earnest about wishing to marry me?
Yes, Jane, marry me. Even if you don't love me, I can't expect that passion in you. No one can love as I love you.
Oh, Mr. Rochester, I do. I do.
Jane. Jane, why didn't you tell me before?
I'm only Jane Eyre, sir.
Jane Eyre. Jane Eyre. Will you marry me, Jane? Say yes. Say it quickly, Jane. Say yes, Edward. I'll marry you. I'll be Mrs. Rochester in 4 weeks' time. Say it, Jane.
Yes, Edward. I'll marry you. I'll be Mrs. Rochester in 4 weeks' time.
Waiting.
Well, get up, child. It's almost time to attend Miss Eyre, for she is dressed.
Oh, mademoiselle looks so beautiful. Lay alone and peep through the door.
Yes. Doubtless love has lent beauty to the plain Jane Eyre. I've heard it said that great love can make beauty. Come along, child. It's almost time. Oh. Oh, did you ever see a man so impatient? There. He's looking at his watch again.
Are they going away, Scatcherd?
Oh, yes. They're leaving immediately after the wedding.
You need to see Mrs. Cole immediately.
Mrs.
Poole?
Tell Mrs. Poole Mr. Mason has returned from the West Indies and desires to see her.
Yes.
And what we have heard is correct, it seems. Mrs. Poole.
Mr. Mason, this is most unexpected. We did not know you were in here.
On urgent business.
Have you seen Mr. Rochester?
No, we have only just arrived in Thornfield.
Well, you have come at a most inconvenient time, sir. Oh,
that is obvious, Mrs. Poole. But it should also be obvious that I have not come to see Mr. Rochester. How is she?
Tolerably well, sir. At times better than others.
You seem most agitated, Mrs. Poole.
I do not wish to be caught here talking with you without the consent of Mr. Rochester.
And let us go upstairs to your rooms.
If you'll excuse me, sir, I'll take you up to the back. We are less likely to meet the other members of the household.
Will you join hands? Dearly beloved, we are gathered here today in the sight of God and his holy tabernacle to join together this man and this woman in the bonds of holy matrimony, which is an honorable estate Christ adorned and beautified by his presence, and is commended to be honorable among all men. It is therefore not to be entered into unadvisedly or lightly, but reverently and discreetly, soberly and in fear of God. Into this estate, these two persons have come now to be joined. And if either of you know of any impediment why ye should not lawfully be joined together in holy matrimony, ye do now confess it, or forever hereafter hold your peace.
Stop. I declare an impediment. I declare this marriage to be illegal.
What is the nature of this impediment? Perhaps we
get
can...
Get Adele inside quickly.
What is happening?
What is the nature of this impediment?
A previous marriage. Mr. Rochester has a wife living.
Who are you?
My name is Briggs. I'm a solicitor from Chesney Lane, London.
What proof have you of this?
I have here an affidavit signed by a client of mine. It reads as follows. I affirm and prove that on the 20th of October, 1842, Edward Fairfax Rochester married my sister Bertha Mason at Spanish Town, Jamaica. The record of the marriage can be found in the register of that church.
If this document be legal, it may prove a marriage, but it does not prove I have a wife living.
You have a wife living in this house. I have a witness to that fact.
You, Mr. Rochester!
His wife is my sister, and she is living in Thornfield. In fact, I have just seen her.
Impossible! Why, I've known Mr. Rochester these 15 years.
I have just returned from the Indies and heard by accident of this impending ceremony in London.
May God punish me, as if he'd not punished me enough already. There will be no wedding today.
How much longer do we have to wait?
I have sent Grace Poole to fetch my wife.
Is that entirely necessary? Mrs. Poole has told us that she's in one of her worst phases today. It might be dangerous to bring
her. You will
power.
Wait. Gentlemen, my wife.
Mm.
That has been my life for the past 15 years. I was tricked into a marriage with her when I was 24 years old in Jamaica. Her mother was a raving lunatic. She shortly followed in the same path. My life was indescribably... I soon realized my only chance was to bring her here to England where no one knew I was married. I hoped, foolishly, I could hide her here at Thornfield. Now, Jane, you know why I hate Thornfield, knowing what it has inside its walls. You may as well leave, gentlemen. Your business here is finished. Jane. You won't leave me.
I must.
You hate me now. There's every reason why you should. You love me no longer.
I will love you as long as I live.
Then take one look at my life. When you're gone, all happiness will be torn away.
I shall trust in God and hope to meet you again. Beyond all fear.
Jane, you're stronger than I. Stay here. Let's be happy now. I'll love you all my life.
Oh, my dear master. God bless you. And keep you close to me. In spirit. Always.
Jane! Jane! My love. My life. My happiness.
How long before we see one another? Or shall I see you ever again? I think not. How desolate the world is. There is no one person on earth as lonely as you, Jane Eyre. You are like that thorn tree, bent with the wind. I must not. But if I go away, how far must I go to get away from the sorrow?
I have a string tied under my heart, inextricably knotted to a similar string under yours.
I hear your voice whispering to me.
Jane.
Only the wind.
Jane.
Where are you?
Jane.
I hear him. I hear his voice. Wait for me. I'm coming. Wait for me.
Just the same quiet eyes. Oh, thank God. Thank God you've come.
Do not grieve for me, Mrs. Fairfax. It's partly for happiness.
And partly
tell me quickly,
What does this desolation mean? From the hill, it seemed as though the house had been burned.
The west wing. Fortunately, not the whole house. One night, not very long after you had left us, while we were all sleeping, she got out of her locked room and set light to your bed. The servants and I got Adele safely into the garden. We woke Mr. Rochester. He went into the garden with us. By then, the whole wing was on fire. And then we saw her.
His wife?
Yes. She was standing on the roof, waving her arms. Oh, it was a terrible sight. Her black hair was streaming against the flames. She was screaming and shouting. Before we could restrain him, Mr. Rochester had rushed back into the house. We saw him climb out of the window and approach her. And then, with a terrifying scream, she jumped.
But he... is he safe? Oh, tell me he's not dead.
No, he's not dead.
Oh, thank God. Then he's here.
Yes, he is here.
Is that you, Mrs. Fairfax?
Yes, yes, Mr. Rochester. Oh, you shouldn't try to walk alone. John or Lear would have guided you if you had called.
I couldn't bear it in the house any longer. It was full of movement, as if she were here again. I could hear her skirts in the passage. She must never come back. Never come back to be tied to a blind invalid. Leave me for a while.
Yes, sir.
Send Leah to fetch me when it grows dark. Is it twilight yet?
It's getting near nightfall, sir.
Well, I shall sit for a while. Is someone there? Someone's there. Who is it? Leah? Is that you, Betty? Would you jest with me? I'm not amused. Who is it?
Don't you know?
Oh, no. This is some dream. These are her very fingers. Her small, slight fingers. Tears. Who has tears for me?
You're Jane.
Tell me I'm not dreaming or my heart will burst.
Oh, my dear master, I've come home, never to leave again.
Jane. 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 Jane.